mexicano.
¡Viva!
Español.
¡Viva!
Latino.
¡Viva!
Hispano.
¡Viva!
Chicano.
¡Power!
After Joaquin, The Crusade for Justice, a KBDI production, a retrospective of the Denver-based civil rights Chicano advocacy group.
I am the masses of my people, and I refuse to be absorbed.
After Joaquin, The Crusade for Justice, Thursday at 9 p.m. on 12.
It's a quiet, stately little building right in the heart of Denver. The architect thought that the life of a community should be formal and orderly, and above all, permanent. But the workers who built it must have made a mistake, for the cornerstone of this building is change. For instance, look, how do you explain that figure up there? Someone who died. A young man named Junior. This is the Crusade for Justice. Ah, you are thinking of legends you have heard. Rumors of guns and bombs. Rumors of poetry and a great singing of people. Rumors. I will have to tell you more. You see, once these doors were open to young people, imagine for a moment that these doors were always open. Imagine in these hallways, hundreds of people. Downstairs, an art gallery. Next to that, a Chicano bookstore. Imagine classrooms filled with young people learning organization and leadership, how to write poetry, how to print newspapers, how to paint murals. Imagine on these stairs, hurrying feet, perhaps on their way to the big square stage to learn teatro and ballet folklorico. Imagine here something of a cultural renaissance. For the voices raised here once overflowed the stately little building and rolled out across the nation. All across the country during the 1960s, people were questioning American values long taken for granted. Among the Chicanos of the Southwest, this re-evaluation was particularly intense. Just as mainstream Americans began to wonder if their system still worked, Chicanos began to declare that it had never worked, at least not for them. The issues underlying El Movimiento were graphic. They had been brewing for years. Hispanic farmers displaced from their ancestral lands, farm workers living in subhuman conditions, women in massive numbers trapped by the welfare system, youth dying in American barrios and American wars, education which denied both culture and language. The second largest minority in the United States had the highest unemployment, the highest rate of high school dropout, the lowest income. And even those professionals who had made the superhuman effort to escape the barrio and the accent, even they found, on the other side of the tracks, discrimination. They now faced a painful and self-denying experience of living down their Spanish surnames. So despite the pressures to conformity in the United States, most Chicanos had retained their cultural identity. The civil rights movement transformed this racial identity from an excuse for suppression into a source of collective power. The new leadership that arose was firmly rooted in the Chicano people. And in Denver, Colorado, that leadership was represented by Corky Gonzáles. In this urban center of the Southwest, culture was a primary concern. Corky Gonzáles first emerged on the national front of El Movimiento as the author of a poem, Yo Soy Joaquin, which is considered the first major literary work of the Chicano movement. It was visualized and distributed nationally in 1969 in this pioneering film by Teatro Campesino. The poem brought a shock of insight and identification in the urban communities, especially among young Chicanas and Chicanos.
I am Joaquin, lost in a world of confusion, caught up in a whirl of an Anglo society. Confused by the rules, scorned by attitudes, suppressed by manipulations, and destroyed by modern society. My fathers have lost the economic battle and won the struggle of cultural survival. And now I must choose between the paradox of victory of the spirit despite physical hunger, or to exist in the grasp of American social neurosis, sterilization of the soul, and a full stomach.
I wrote I Am Joaquin because I wanted to say something historical about ourselves, and something about our present, and something about our future. I want to inspire young people to understand themselves, and to, and as I found myself, that they would find themselves. I wanted them to identify with the past, and to understand the tragedy, the sorrow, and the joy, and the beauty of our people.
Rodolfo Corky Gonzáles is, above all, a child of his times. He was born in Denver in 1928, the son of a migrant farm worker. He attended 4 grade schools, 3 junior highs, and 2 high schools, and he had a brief taste of college, which he could not afford. Instead, he went to work in a slaughterhouse, read voraciously, and boxed. The reading gave him a broad, keen understanding of his world. The boxing was his key to a better life. Immensely talented, he became a top contender in the national arena. The newspapers of the 1950s are filled with Corky Gonzáles. He was a media hero whose every move was photographed. In 1955, he retired from boxing and began his family. A hard worker with a golden touch, and of course, great popular appeal. He was as successful in business as he had been in boxing. Politicians courted him. Civic leaders called him a credit to his race. But few politicians and civic leaders guessed how deeply he identified with that race. By the early 60s, he who had once organized votes for the Democratic Party was now organizing marches and protests. A passionate speaker, always visible, he drew ardent support and heavy fire in equal measure. From within his own ranks, he was criticized for his early stand on women's issues and his domination of the Denver movement. Outside El Movimiento, he was accused of racism and incitement to violence. He was always larger than life, and so he comes to us today, a larger than life reflection of the changes of our times.
But I continued in the political arena and got involved because I was advised that that was the way to change things for our total society. And through the political involvement, I had this tremendous, I would say it was a background from my father, who raised us by himself since my mother died when I was an infant, a principle of not putting up with hypocrites, not being able to compromise a principle. Being poor, you had nothing to lose, and all you had was your character. And if you couldn't live up to your principles, then you were not a man. And I having that within me, I found that I wanted things changed in a hurry. If we produced a certain amount of votes and numbers, then I wanted those changes in employment, the changes in education, the changes in health and welfare. I wanted them immediately.
I have come a long way to nowhere. Unwillingly dragged by that monstrous technical industrial giant called progress and Anglo success. I look at myself. I watch my brothers. I shed tears of sorrow. I sow seeds of hate. I withdraw to the safety within the circle of life, my own people.
I started to practice what I had been preaching by working with young people, by being in the community, by being there when they needed us, by trying to inspire them to better things, to giving them help in understanding their history and their culture and their identity so that they felt this self-worth that makes a full human being, that makes a full man or a woman. And I enjoyed that. It was an arena that I felt comfortable in, that I felt more comfortable in the parks, in the streets, in the projects, in the places that I'd organized to register to vote. I was now organizing to protest injustice and inequities in the system.
Corky Gonzáles founded the Crusade for Justice in 1967. What it became during the next few years is captured in this national documentary, Yo Soy Chicano, produced by Jesus Treviño for KCET Los Angeles in 1972.
Well, first of all, we started the Crusade because the need for an organization that was completely independent from any political ties, from any economic ties. So we started the Crusade to create a civil rights organization, which we feel has now become a human rights organization. And part of it was social services to help people in every area, from housing, food, legal problems, bonding. The other area was that of the cultural level, and that was to provide an awareness of ourselves, to start to teach the people, to give them pride and dignity and a self-image that was one of respect. And we've done this by creating our school, creating our art gallery, our bookstore. And then one of the other areas which we feel is most important is the development of leadership and commitment to the community. We conduct fishermen's meetings to develop this leadership every Wednesday night for the last 4 years. This is our belief that you can destroy leaders, but you can't destroy a philosophy or a people. And so we continue to develop leadership. I do teach one class here, which is called the Philosophy of the Chicano Education. And what we're telling the students in the university is to make the complete circuit from the barrio or from his home to the school and make a complete circuit back to the community to be to contribute, not to exploit. So this was one of the main purposes, to relate the farm worker struggle, the land struggle, the urban struggle. And in doing that, we forgot a lot about the urban problems. And we have to come back and really set expertise, document and really bring out a strong philosophy related to the urban struggle. We have young people that are developing professionally, and that we are developing professionally to become those administrators, those leaders, and those community people that will teach a community how to control themselves. This is community control. Economically, we want to bring ourselves together to control our own economic life. We recognize the importance of having a central location. And then we invited the whole world to come here, gave our young people the ability to articulate, to give out their feelings and their emotions, and to put their own ideas to work, to be important in something that was the most dramatic movement in the history of this country. And again, I say we are the most unique people in this country, and that we do not come across the Atlantic Ocean or the Pacific Ocean, that we are a mestizo, creation of the Spanish and Indian, and the Indio, which makes us part and parcel of the land and the two continents. We did not come to America. America came to us. And this is hard for Eastern people to recognize that, or people who read history from Jamestown to the West instead of reading history from Mexico and Aztlan to the East. And we came together, and what I might say one of the most beautiful orchestrated sounds of music and voices and people coming together, young gangs that wouldn't cross their own boundaries, had never been closer than half a mile from each other. We're here together, going to the same dining room, eating the same food, going to the same bathrooms, going to down the same halls, and the same, and learning to get along, and finding that there was a tremendous beauty in coming together.
They came from all over, not only young gang leaders from Denver, but also seasoned farm workers from California, political organizers from Texas, land rights activists from New Mexico. They came to this living urban laboratory. For whereas Chavez spoke most eloquently for bread and Tijerina most forcibly for land, what this urban Chicano movement symbolized was culture. And so Chicanos from many walks of life converged on the Crusade building to lend support and to attend workshops on everything from the philosophy of education to the arts. This living laboratory attracted not only Chicanos, but also national figures from the Black movement, the American Indian movement, and the women's movement. The first National Chicano Youth Liberation Conference drew 1,500 people in 1969. By 1972, attendance had grown to 3,000.
I ride with revolutionists against myself. I am rural, coarse, and brutal. I am the mountain Indian, superior over all. The thundering hoofbeats are my horses. The chattering machine guns are death to all of me. Yaqui, Tarahumara, Chamula, Zapotec, Mestizo, Español. I have been the bloody revolution. The victor, the vanquished. I have killed and been killed.
The times were heady, and in a burst of newfound identity and cultural pride, the rhetoric strong. But it was not just rhetoric, for relations between Chicanos and law enforcement in the Southwest have often been marked by violence. The history of confrontation goes back at least as far as the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo and the massacres by the early Texas Rangers. It continues relentlessly through the burnings and lynchings in 19th century California, the violent suppression of farm workers' strikes in the early 20th century, the pogroms against Zoot Suiters and Pachucos in the 1940s, the mass uprootings and deportations of the 1950s, and always in the city barrio, the alienation between the young people and the police. As the Crusade for Justice began gaining widespread support and national credibility, so did the violence increase. Confrontation became common between the police and individuals, between the police and the community. Community relations deteriorated, and even a peaceful demonstration on education might lead to bloodshed. Corky Gonzáles knew the power and the price of words. He knew sometimes the price is death, but death came with a surprisingly painful twist. It came not to Corky, but to one of the Crusade's valued young people, a 20-year-old teacher of ballet folklorico, Luis Junior Martinez. Junior Martinez died on March 17, 1973. And that day marks a turning point for the Crusade. The cultural idealism and enthusiasm were sobered by a stunning show of arms. For the police launched so forceful an attack on the Crusade that one of its buildings was literally shattered. 19 people were injured, 36 were arrested, and one, a young dancer, apprehended for jaywalking, was dead.
Junior was one of those exceptional young men who you couldn't help but love. He's very close to us. And he also was a young man that had taken a position that he would never take another beating from any man or any person unjustly. And the last time was over crossing the street to ask the police why they were arresting a young man, and they said it was for jaywalking, and that he was now under arrest for jaywalking. And it became a confrontation that no one knows what exactly happened, except the policeman backed him up into an alley, and Junior was found dead. The policeman was shot, and part of our buildings were blown up, and we lost a tremendous young man. There have been other juniors, and they've taken their stands. When that happens, there's a new respect. I'm sorry that sometimes to say that we have to gain respect through this type of action. But all the same, it's important because some of our young people don't understand, or may not understand, and many do, that his act of resistance gave us strength. Knowing that not only in our hearts, but in their eyes, meaning the system and the establishment, that we will not be treated like animals, we won't be subdued, we won't, will not be bent. And this was the one of the most important messages that Junior left for us, and at the cost of his life.
And now the trumpet sounds. The music of the people stirs the revolution. Like a sleeping giant, it slowly rears its head to the sound of tramping feet, clamoring voices, mariachi strains, fiery tequila explosions, smell of chili verde, and soft brown eyes of expectation for a better life. And in all the fertile farmland, the barren plains, mountain villages, smoke-mired cities, we start to move.
And that's where I feel the regrets is that those who sacrificed so much and suffered so much received so little in return. And the many unrecognized heroes of the movement, and some who have to remain anonymous because of the actions they took, which helped to provide the openings in industry, the openings in business, the openings in government, the openings in political life, that they haven't been able to, if not profit, at least to glory in what they did.
What is left of it all today? To the casual ear, only rumors and legends. To the casual eye, only an empty building up for sale. It is the 1980s. The term Hispanic is more fashionable than Chicano, and the image that Denver Chicanos project to the nation is not a fiery, inspirational leader, but a polished negotiator of coalitions, the young mayor, Federico Peña. It would be easy to say, an era has ended, the Crusade is history, times change. Times change, and they don't. The continuum of a community runs deeper than the casual eye, the casual ear, can perceive. During the 1983 Peña election, for instance, The Chicano community was so organized and mobilized, so conscious of cultural identity, that thousands of people registered who had never before in their lives voted. Perhaps such accomplishment came not from a single brilliant campaign, but from the decades of Chicano development which preceded it. That cultural consciousness is not going to go away. And Corky Gonzáles still makes the headlines. He isn't going to go away. Nor will the problems that underlay the Chicano movement, for unemployment is as high as it ever was, and the high school dropout rate is higher.
I'm not unhappy about my position in life. I'm very happy with my children that have come from my home. I'm happy with the development of my grandchildren and the children of my friends and those people who have maintained a steady political direction. And I would say that the movement is not dead. It's resting, and the emergencies that come about will bring us all together, and that there will be a new resurgence and a new renaissance in the Chicano movement.
Mexicano!
Viva!
Español!
Viva!
Latino!
Viva!
Hispano!
Viva!
Chicano!
Power!
Or whatever I call myself. I look the same. I feel the same. I cry and I sing the same. I am the masses of my people, and I refuse to be absorbed. I am Joaquin. The odds are great, but my spirit is strong. My faith, unbreakable. My blood is pure. I am Aztec prince and Christian Christ. I shall endure. I will endure.